For generations, we have dreamed about a place to live and work in space, a space station. And right now, 260 miles above us, that dream is a reality. We dreamed that life up there would benefit life down here. That dream has come true. Can research on board the space station lead to cleaner drinking water on Earth? Can it help farmers produce better crops? Can it inspire a generation of students? Can it even save a life? The answer to these questions is yes. It already has. As the work aboard the International Space Station begins to reach its potential, the benefits to humanity are evident. These are just a few of the stories from people who have realized those benefits in their own words.
Is that two? You say two?
I found a big lump in the side of my face, and I kept going to doctor after doctor. And I was in so much pain at that time. I was like dying in bed. It hurt so bad. I've never been in so much pain. I went for my first MRI, and then it showed up with like hundreds of tumors all over. And then they sent me to, not Dr. Sutherland, but someone who works in his office. And he thought it was neurofibromatosis, which I have.
We didn't even realize what that was. We'd always heard it called the elephant man disease. There's different types of neurofibromatosis. One of them, the tumors grow on the outside of your skin. The other one, the tumors grow on the inside, and hers grow on the inside.
A long time ago, when we were thinking about this, we approached McDonald Detweiler & Associates. It's a company that happens to be located in Canada that built robots for space. They built what Canadians call Canadarm, and then they constructed the special purpose dexterous manipulator for the International Space Station. And the idea was, if they could build such complex robots, perhaps in collaboration with medicine, we could build a robot that could operate inside an MRI machine.
We did not realize that it was built out of the same material as the space arm, and we're quite amazed that that's what he had made it out of.
But it's the multi-dexterity of the robot, and that robot could perform tasks that made us become increasingly confident that we could overcome the challenges related to building a robot that could operate inside an MRI machine with the precision, the accuracy, and the dexterity of a neurosurgeon. It just so happened that the first individual was a young woman, and the young woman harbored a fairly complex tumor underneath the front part of her brain. A machine like NeuroArm can manipulate tools at an accuracy of 50 microns. That is overwhelmingly superior to what the best surgeon might be able to do.
I think it's fabulous. To me, it's actually mind-boggling that someone can take that material and put it into a life-saving device that can help millions of people.
I honestly think that right now I'd be bedridden. I would not be able to get out of bed if it was not for my doctors. My parents would be taking care of my kid right now. I guess, like, I'm glad that it hopefully helped people who have my disease, and I hope that it helps people who need surgery in the future. If they're ever propositioned with a chance in the future to have something done like this, I hope they take it.
Estamos en la comunidad Tres Picos.
We're in the town of Tres Picos.
Es una purificadora de agua.
This is a water purifier that uses technology developed by NASA and makes free purified water available to all of the people of the community. The technology was developed by NASA for the International Space Station. In this community, the water comes from the town, but in other communities, where we are working in Chiapas, it comes from the wells, from rivers, from streams, from springs. The water can come from practically any source that you can imagine. People who drink contaminated water alter their health. Their children's development is diminished.
My name is Raquel Perez Perez, and I am the campus assistant of this school. There were lots of children with parasites and stomach bugs before the purified water came. Now the kids are healthier because they now drink purified water from the plant. The energy that is being used is solar. And the children come to recess with their cups and they get the water themselves. They are happy now and they want to come and drink water all the time.
When you get involved with a plant of this kind that gives people access to pure water for human consumption, that is going to prevent people from getting sick. What you're really doing is improving people's health, but also you're improving the economy for these people. If we could put one of these plants in every community and have people use it, you would have resolved one of the most important sources of health problems, at least in the rural areas of Mexico. That's the truth. If it is well used, it can change the lives of an entire community. It gives you children that learn more. It gives you parents who spend less money on medicine. It changes the future.
Our farm is called AWG Farms, started back in 1975. It's a family-run farm. I have two brothers now, and my son-in-law is in the operation. This will be a third-generation farm in this particular area. Main crop is sugar beets. Then we have spring wheat, sunflowers, soybeans, corn, and once in a while we'll raise some edible beans. Remote sensing is a way to look at our crops during the growing season to be able to determine if we need to do any monitoring of disease and or fertility differences. There was an organization over in Grand Forks, North Dakota called UMAC. That organization put a camera on the space station called Isaac. Well, the biggest problem with satellite imagery is the fact that Landsat we get every 16 days. And on that 16th day in this region, if we have cloud cover, that image is virtually useless for us. So then we have to wait another 16 days. Biggest thing with Isaac, we would get much more often. When we wanted to get that particular image, Isaac gave it to us when we wanted it versus a more rotational type satellite. And they were able to get imagery to us with a couple bands of light, the more necessary ones that we needed, which is near infrared and red. Near-infrared band is something to do with biomass, how the crop is growing. More biomass, usually more yield potential. We're able to obtain a piece of software that's written by a local programmer in this region that allows us to take these images and manipulate them into zones within the field itself. And by doing that, we can see different patterns in the field. And within those patterns, we can manage the field differently based off of biomass or reflectance of the field itself. It's just a tool that we can use as a reference to be able to make better decisions. And by doing that, our farm is more profitable. And that to me is very important.
I grew up out in the country in Indiana. Corn and soybeans were the main crops. I had always been interested in technology and in science. Being out in the rural setting, there wasn't a whole lot of support for this. Space Jam is an annual weekend Boy Scout event, and we do all kinds of technology-based things. We have about 1,000 people that come every year. This is our 7th year doing it, and it's a blast every year. The contact with the International Space Station was one of the driving forces that helped to create Space Jam. In fact, the first Space Jam was really basically only about the contact.
It was a dream of the ham radio operator to say, hey, I want to talk to the astronauts on the space station. How cool could that be? That's the top of the game.
Each year we call up the International Space Station and we give these young kids the opportunity to ask questions to the astronaut.
Is it true that it will take over a year to get to Mars and back over?
It absolutely is true.
The first time that I remember really having this real impression was I think the 3rd year we did this. I was in charge of actually calling up the space station and establishing the contact. We were out in the middle of the night in a field, and I said, NA1SS, NA1SS, this is WB9SA calling for a scheduled contact. Do you copy, over? And I said it again, and all of a sudden, real crisp comes back, WB9SA, this is the International Space Station, how are you doing tonight? And we're like, oh, this is amazing. I graduated as valedictorian, and I was lucky enough to be admitted to Princeton with a complete scholarship, and I then moved to San Francisco, where I'm a software engineer. So I went from living on a farm to living downtown in San Francisco, writing software for people. It was a really amazing experience to do all that.
Minas Gerais is a large state. Our territory is about the size of France, and we consist of 853 units and municipalities. There are large distances between our communities and many very isolated rural communities. We are using new technology that impacts the quality of prenatal care and the diagnostic capacity of the primary care doctor in these situations involving distant, isolated communities.
Providing medical care for people in remote locations, like distant rural communities or the International Space Station, can be difficult because trained medical personnel are not always available. NASA research teams develop techniques that enable astronauts aboard the space station with minimal training to operate an ultrasound device using simple printed guides. The ultrasound images are transmitted in real time to a doctor back on Earth, who can make medical decisions without actually being aboard the station. These same techniques have been adapted for use with portable ultrasound devices in communities where expert medical care is not always available.
My name is Joaquim Diniz. I'm a doctor in the town of Manga. In Manga, people live with a particularity, and that is isolation. We have a geographical barrier, that is the São Francisco River, which is both a blessing for the region, but it also isolates us. We live in a region where financial resources are few. People do not have a lot of work, but they are honest, good people, who do not have much opportunity. So there are many needy people who need these resources and rely only on this institution to provide assistance. This is a technology that helps us solve many problems.
Que
That was the case of a patient who came to the hospital with severe respiratory failure, and the people realized she would die in just 20 to 30 minutes. We ran, we talked with Dr. Parzelli, who was training us to use the ultrasound. He came and applied the ultrasound and discovered large amounts of fluid around her lungs and heart. We performed the procedure and drained a lot of fluid. In 20 minutes, 10 minutes, the woman immediately experienced an improvement and in half an hour was already walking. It was like a miracle, arise and walk. She was dying in front of us without people knowing what was happening. This ultrasound was instrumental in saving the life of that patient.
We've only begun to see the International Space Station's benefits to humanity. These are just a few of the ways that the science and research conducted aboard the ISS is improving lives today. There are countless more benefits to come, sometimes in ways that we have never predicted. Every day, hundreds of scientists around the world are working with the crews on board the International Space Station to perform life-changing research. Every day, they use the weightless environment of space to conduct experiments in ways that can't be done here on Earth. And every day, those experiments improve life for people all over the world. This will be the legacy of the International Space Station's benefits for humanity.